We're very fortunate today to have as our keynote speaker, Dr. Jeff Gordon. Jeff is the Dr. Robert J. Glaser Distinguished University Professor at Washington University. He received his AB from Oberlin and then his MD degree from University of Chicago. He joined the Washington University faculty after completing his clinical training in internal medicine and gastroenterology. And he served as the department chairman of molecular biology and pharmacology from 1991 to 2004 before he became the founding director of the Center for Genome Sciences and System Biology. He's a member of the National Academy of Sciences, where he serves as the chair of the section of medical physiology and metabolism. He's a member of the American Academy of Arts and Sciences, as well as the Institute of Medicine of the National Institutes. His list of awards and honors are long and very distinguished. I'm not going to try to attempt to enumerate any of them. I think among Jeff's amazing qualities, in addition to the spectacular research that you're going to hear about, is a real commitment that he has to education and mentoring. He served from 1994 to 2003 as the director of the university's Division of Biological and Biomedical Sciences, and which oversees the training of all the MD and PhD students. And he personally mentored over 55 PhD and MD PhD students and 58 postdocs. I have no doubt that he will educate all of us today with his talk, which is entitled The Human Gut Microbiome and Malnutrition, describing some work where he's really pioneering a very important new field in medicine. And it's with great pleasure, please put your hands together and welcome Dr. Jeff Gordon.
It's a privilege and pleasure to be here to share some thoughts with you about postnatal development, but from a slightly different perspective. Our partners in crime, our co-conspirators. These are the vast collections of microbes that live together with us. But speaking of living together and taking a shared journey of discovery, there's a wonderful proverb, an African proverb, that says that if you want to go fast, you can go alone. If you want to go far, you go together. And that's been my great fortune to be accompanied by an inspiring group of colleagues, of students, and of postdocs. And this is a snapshot of the lab today. And I'll highlight the work of several people during the course of the hour I have with you. So we live in an amazing century where the human population is predicted to expand to 9 billion in less than 40 years. There's issues of sustainable agriculture. There's enormous transformation in the cultural traditions of many different human populations. The consequences of this, there's going to be enormous pressure to feed healthy foods to our fellow humans over the course of the next several decades. And to do so, I believe we need a new vision, a more integrated, more strategic, and more data-driven process or pipeline to decide what kind of affordable foods we can and should produce, how to prepare and preserve them, and how to distribute them to consumer populations that will most benefit from the stored energy and nutrients in those diets. To help this process, a preclinical pipeline or platform, I think, needs to be developed in which we construe the nutritional value of foods not in absolute terms, but in part in terms of the vast population of microbes that live in our guts or our human gut microbiota. So why do I believe, together with the people in our laboratory and others in the field, that we should design foods for the future from the inside out, not just from the outside in? And why should we look at the metabolic output of our microbiota in terms of the nutritional substrates that we present to these microbes? Well, if you look at the course of mammalian evolution, different mammalian species at different positions in the mammalian tree of life, and ask what are the principal drivers of the configuration of their gut microbiota, as several people in the lab have asked over the course of the last several years, you'll see that mammalian gut microbiota don't cluster based on the position of mammals on the mammalian tree of life, but rather principally cluster dependent upon the diet of the mammals. So herbivores will cluster together, carnivores will cluster together. So we think that diet has been a tremendous driver of the coevolution of our microbiota with humans and other mammalian species. So this is Tanya Yatsunenko, and she was a very, very talented graduate student in the lab. During the time she was a graduate student, she discovered, and her life partner discovered her, Drew Grimm, who is known to you, a pediatric gastroenterologist. Tanya, during the time that she was in the laboratory, was very interested in the gut microbiota as an organ with different cell lineages, an organ that would assemble during postnatal life, an organ that would shape the metabolism not only of its own members, but the metabolism of its host species, humans. So she, together with a number of colleagues, including Mark Mineri, sampled the gut microbiota of individuals living on three continents initially, in three countries representing very distinct cultural traditions, four metropolitan areas of the United States, two villages in the Amazonas state of Venezuela. These are villages populated by Amerindians, an agrarian lifestyle, and four villages in the southern region of Malawi, thanks to Mark. And this sampling included adults, family members, including siblings that were aged from anywhere from a few months all the way through the ninth decade of life. So this is a large population, over 500 individuals, representing over 150 families. And what she found was that the gut microbiota, and I'm going to pause and say I'll use the term microbiota to refer to the organisms that together assemble to form a microbial community in a particular body habitat. And I'll use the term microbiome to refer to the genes that are represented in the genomes of the members of these communities. So in each of these different areas of the world, as well as in a group of individuals living in Bangladesh, Tanya observed that there's evolution towards an adult-like configuration in terms of the species assemblages during the first 3 years of life. So it takes about 3 years to assemble these communities to look like adults in that region of the world that's being sampled. That if you're a member of a family, that your microbes, your microbial community structure will be more similar to family members than to unrelated individuals living in other households. So the definition of a family and the importance of looking at these questions from a cultural anthropologic perspective is very important, because what defines a family? There is also a marital signature of the microbiota. So partners cohabitating for long periods of time will have a microbiota that's more similar to one another than individuals living in separate households. And we are obsessed with the value of twins in understanding the relative role of human genotype versus environmental exposures in shaping microbial community structure in the gut. And our studies of monozygotic twin pairs and dizygotic twin pairs, stretching from 1 year of age all the way through adulthood, indicates that the gut microbial communities have an overall structure that's not more similar among monozygotic twin pairs than dizygotic twin pairs. So let me just repeat that. A monozygotic twin pair will not have gut communities that are more similar to one another overall than dizygotic twin pairs. So that emphasizes the great role that early environmental exposures have in shaping community structure later on in life. And as pediatricians who see infants and children at various stages, including in the NICU, it's very important to behold the fact that the interaction of people with their surroundings has a legacy, and that legacy is portrayed in terms of the microbial assemblages in our various body habitats. Now, this legacy of microbial exposures is long-lived. So this is Jeremiah Faith. He finished up his postdoc in the lab just a month and a half ago. This field, as I'll comment at the end of my talk, is a wonderful chemo attractant for people with different disciplinary interests. And Jay came to the lab with a background in applied mathematics and microbiology, which is an enormous sweet spot in terms of understanding microbial community structure and its dynamic properties. But what Jay did, together with another very talented postdoc who now is at Yale University, Jay's at Mount Sinai, and that other individual is Andy Goodman, I don't have his picture here, is to devise ways of taking a previously frozen fecal sample, even if that sample has been preserved for many years at minus 80 degrees, and to resurrect life in that sample in the form of a culture collection. So I can take a picture of Scott, so to speak, metaphorically, in terms of his microbiota, if he were to deposit, with IRB approval, his distal intestinal contents in a place that we could access it, and to culture the majority of microbial diversity in these multi-well plates. So we do a limiting dilution, use Poisson to define a dilution where if there is growth in a well, you have at least a 95% chance that that growth will be from a single microbial cell. So each well that supports growth will have a clonal collection of cells. So hypothetically, this could be a portrayal of Scott Saunders, at least in terms of his gut microbiota, in a 384 well plate. And these organisms hate oxygen. So if you write the word oxygen and show it to them, they'll all die. It's critically important that all of these procedures occur in these anaerobic chambers. So there's been a lot of advances with anaerobic microbiology. We're able to create these culture collections, and then we have robots inside these so-called koi chambers, and you're able to compress the culture collection. So you have a personal culture collection, and that's going to be an important technology I'm going to talk about later on. But freezing in a moment in time, somebody's got microbes. The question is whether those microbes endure for long periods of time. So Jay has developed a new way of using culture-independent methods, PCR. There's a barcode of life to classify microbial life. It's the gene that encodes the principal RNA in the small subunit of a ribosome. In bacteria, that's called 16S ribosomal RNA gene. And people do PCR of this gene and sequence it. There's a lot of noise that sometimes confounds our estimates of how much diversity of microbial life is there. Jay has just developed a new method that's called a low error amplicon sequencing method. And he's been able to more precisely define the number of different microbial species in an individual. It's around 100. He sampled 37 individuals over a period of up to 5 years with this very accurate way of classifying bacterial diversity, and finds that there's remarkable stability. These were adults. This stability follows a power law, so you can extrapolate that most strains are present for decades. He cultured, and this is the awesome power of DNA sequencing right now. The first microbial genome that we sequenced in the lab, it took us 2.5 years, that was a labor that combined both inspiration and perspiration. Right now, we can sequence 192 microbial genomes in a single lane of an 8-lane flow cell in an Illumina HiSeq 2500 instrument. So Jay was able to create personal culture collections from 6 individuals who are weight stable, sampled over 7 to 69 weeks apart, and sequenced these strains and found that not only are the species stable, but there are different derivatives of a given species. Those are called strains. The repertoire of strains that we harbor over time is remarkably stable. What does that mean for you as a pediatrician? Well, the legacy of early environmental exposures that an individual has as this microbial community is assembling is a long-lived legacy and could very likely shape our metabolic phenotypes because the genes in the microbiome encode traits that aren't represented in our human genome. So our metabolic phenotypes are a synopsis of the products of our Homo sapiens genes and our microbial genes. So our metabolic phenotypes, our physiological phenotypes, our immunological phenotypes, because after all, our innate and adaptive immune systems co-evolve with the microbiota as it's assembled. So childhood, such a critical period of development, and think of this development as involving both the human cellular component of our superorganism. We're really holobionts, a synopsis of microbial and human cellular and gene parts. This evolution postnatally involving our microbes and our bodies, our human cellular component. So Tanya, in her survey across the planet of microbiota from people representing different age bins, different physiological states, different cultural traditions, revealed a series of biomarkers in the form of genes represented in the microbiome whose proportional representation changes as a function of age. So here we have a multicellular organ, the microbiota, that is programmed to assemble or develop postnatally. And some of the functions whose representation changes as a function of age are critically involved in determining our nutritional status. And this is one example on the left, a series of, and I'm so humbled by the task that I'm putting before you to try to translate all of this, but I appreciate it very much. A series of genes encoding the enzymes that are critical for folate biosynthesis. Those assigned enzymatic products, given enzyme commission numbers, are colored yellow because virtually all genes in that pathway are overrepresented in the microbiomes of infants and young children. They are overrepresented compared to older individuals. So there's a change in the proportional representation of these genes as a function of age. The genes involved in the breakdown of folate increase as a function of age. And there's a whole suite of genes involved in the production of a number of vitamins, cobalamin, biotin, thiamine, that change as a function of age. There are also suites of genes that are involved in the processing of carbohydrates, complex carbohydrates, the biosynthesis of essential and non-essential amino acids. And we also see adaptation. So those programs are shared across the different populations. But there are variants of that program, and we think that these are adaptations to the selections that are imposed upon those populations by available diets. And I don't have time to go through this, but think of a microbiota as having been selected across generations and generations based on the cultural traditions and lifestyles. Bottom line, as pediatricians, when we think about the nutritional needs of a growing infant, it's reassuring that the microbiota not only supplies elements essential for the growth of microbial cells, but folate produced by the microbiota can undoubtedly contribute in critical ways to the support of the host. And we think about epigenetics and methylation, you wonder about the role of the microbiota in defining aspects of our epigenome. But consider the microbiota when establishing recommendations about the nutritional needs of humans at various stages of development. So we now turn to something that you have heard a substantial amount of information about this morning, but I'd like to look at this through the lens of human nutrition and the lens of the microbiota and the interactions between the diet and the microbiota, and ask you, as a group who's dedicating their lives to understanding postnatal development, whether there may be perturbations in the developmental program that I've alluded to. So does the microbiota develop properly in individuals who are at risk for malnutrition? Are reconfigurations of the microbiota, deficiencies in assembly associated not only with risk, but the various aspects of the manifestations of malnutrition. And is severe acute malnutrition part of a spectrum of diseases associated with defective assembly of the microbiota? Are less severe forms of malnutrition different from more severe forms of malnutrition in terms of different pathogenic mechanisms? So Tanya partnered with Mark and Indy to do a study that asks questions that I think are generic questions for those who study human microbial ecology. And if you close your eyes and listen to the questions, you could substitute a number of different diseases, I believe. But in this case, today, we're talking about malnutrition. Are there identifiable configurations of the gut microbiota and microbiome associated with disease? In this case, severe acute malnutrition. If so, could that have not only pathophysiologic, but diagnostic implications? What if you treat a therapeutic intervention? How does that reconfigure the microbiota? Is the pathway for reconfiguration the same in all cases? Are there different pathways depending upon the initial state? And most importantly, if there is a reconfiguration, is it long-lived or transient? So when you withdraw therapy, does the reconfiguration persist or not? If we think about reconfiguration in the parlance of regenerative medicine, can you regenerate this metabolic organ in a way that restores function, and is that regeneration and restoration long-lived? And then, of course, you know, how effective are our current therapies? Can they be optimized? And if there are subtle or not so subtle differences in microbiota structure and function, can we generalize from one population to another? So in an absolutely heroic effort, Indy and Mark and their colleagues, with the sponsorship of the Bill and Melinda Gates Foundation, recruited 317 twin pairs in five villages in southern Malawi. And these children were followed during their first 3 years of life. One of the startling observations to me was that 43% of these twin pairs became discordant for moderate or severe acute malnutrition. Why should there be such a high incidence of discordance? And if we think about the developmental trajectory of a microbiota, even in infants who share a common mother and relatively similar environments, can subtle perturbations early during assembly cause adaptive responses or produce responses in the host that lock in that response or skew it even further? And do we start separating the trajectories from one individual from another? And in fact, are there certain configurations that essentially are locked into a state that are very difficult to perturb further? Now, discordant twin pairs, mono and dizygotic twin pairs who are discordant for either MAM or SAM, provide in Malawi an absolutely ideal clinical trial setting, as Mark and Indy had told us in advance of this study. And that is because the standard of care is to treat both the healthy and the undernourished child in a discordant twin pair because of concerns of food sharing. So the mother wouldn't devote all of her nutritional resources, the nutritional resources available to the unhealthy child and put the healthy child at risk for developing disease. So that means that each child can serve as their own control in a discordant twin pair, observe their microbiome or microbiota before, during, and after treatment with RUTF, the type of RUTF that Indy and Mark referred to. The healthy co-twin, treated at the same time, serves as a within-family control. Different twin pairs, different discordant twin pairs represent other types of controls, and the twin pairs that remain healthy yet other types of control. So the first finding that I think got all of us excited was that there was no significant difference in discordant rate for moderate or severe acute malnutrition among mono versus dizygotic twin pairs, which should implicate that host genotype did not play a dominant role in disease. And there was no effect of gender or zygosity on risk for kwashiorkor or marasmus. So what Tanya did was to sequence the microbiomes in same gender twin pairs that were either concordant for healthy during this period of time or discordant for kwashiorkor. And this is a complicated, try to get this. This panel A over here is somewhat complicated. This is age on the x-axis, and this is an ordination plot, a principal coordinates analysis, and this is the dominant axis of variation. Each sphere represents an individual's fecal microbiome, and the distance between spheres is a reflection of how similar their repertoire of genes encoding enzymes with known function are. And you can see that there's a very strong age gradient, so that in samples over time, there's a change in their positioning in this ordination plot. And this location on PC1 is a proxy for maturation of the microbiome. And if you take a look at twin pairs that are concordant for healthy status, if this works, it's very hard to see, you'll see that in this group, there's a progressive change in the position of their microbiomes as a function of age, and this is over a six-month period of time. So this is a co-twin in a concordant healthy twin pair, one co-twin, other co-twin, and this is the summation of many such twin pairs. So there's a normal developmental trajectory. This is the healthy co-twin in a discordant pair just before, during, and after, 4 weeks after RUTF. And this pointer is not working very well, so you'll have to use my voice as a guide. The first time point is just at the time of diagnosis. The next two time points are two and manual override. Look at that power. Almost as good as a laser sword, but saber. Just before, 2 weeks, 4 weeks during RUTF, and a month after RUTF. So there's a continued progression. You see here with the kwashiorkor twin, there's an effect of RUTF, but there's not this continued evolution of the microbiome, certainly not after RUTF is withdrawn, suggesting that there's might be something wrong with the maturation of this microbiome in the case of kwashiorkor. So how do we go beyond a description of organisms and genes to actually audit the function of a microbiome? So I told you about resurrecting life in the form of a culture collection. There's another way we can resurrect the microbial life in a frozen fecal sample, and that's to transplant that sample into mice that have been reared in a germ-free state. So we can take an individual representing a particular age, physiologic or disease state, and cultural tradition, and transplant that microbiota into multiple animals in a given experiment, and replicate between animals and between those animals in this starting sample most of the microbial life that was present in the donor sample. It's a very robust technique. It was developed in the lab around 2009 by Peter Turnbow. This is our notobiotic facility run by Dave O'Donnell and Maria Carlson. All the people in the lab who do notobiotic experiments do so themselves under the guidance of Dave and Maria, so they learn this technology, which is about six decades old, but very potent for these types of questions. So you can replicate a snapshot of a person's microbiota in multiple animals for a given experiment and repeat that experiment many times and see the same microbiota configuration of that donor's microbiota in these recipient animals. You can give those recipient animals the diet of the donor or diets that represent systematic manipulations of those donor diets. You can give the animal the diet of the donor and then simulate travel by taking that mouse and going from the diet of the donor to the diet representative of another country. You can simulate the effects of westernization that way. You can think about innovative foods and test their effects on the microbiota, its metabolic output, and the effects on the physiology of the animal. These are very powerful methods. They're also methods for ascertaining how much of an individual's physiologic or metabolic phenotype is ascribable to the microbiota. You can ask the question, how much of the feature of the human donor can be transmitted to the recipient mouse? And that's what was done in the case of twin pairs that were discordant for kwashiorkor. So this is Michelle Smith, and she and Tanya teamed up and did a series of microbiota transplants from co-twins and discordant pairs. This is an example of one of their experiments. So the healthy co-twin in the discordant pair, microbiota is transplanted to a series of germ-free mice. These mice are all the same genetic background. They are all about 10 to 12 weeks of age. This is the kwashiorkor co-twins microbiota transplanted into these mice, separate group of mice. All these mice were fed a Malawian diet, that is to say, a diet that represented, based on Mark's survey, the principal components of their daily diet. So we've humanized them at the level of their microbiota and at the level of their diets. And you can see a very impressive discordant weight loss phenotype that's produced. You can also see differences in the microbial community composition of these microbiota because we've replicated these microbiota in multiple animals in similar fashions in each recipient group. So we see differences in the proportional representation of many different bacterial species if the donor has kwashiorkor versus if they were a healthy co-twin. And we go back to this population as a whole, informed by these results, and see if these microbial biomarkers of disease apply. So this is a discovery tool. And there's some very interesting bugs that we see that are represented disproportionately in kwashiorkor compared to healthy co-twins microbiota. One of them, Bilophila wadsworthia, is a hydrogen-consuming, sulfate-reducing organism that's linked to IBD in human beings, as an example. Now, I mentioned early on this diet by microbiota interaction. So this is a sidebar experiment in which the transplants were done just as I said, but instead of just giving a Malawian diet, other groups of animals received a macro and micronutrient sufficient diet. And we asked the question, is it the combination of a kwashiorkor microbiota and the macro and micronutrient insufficient Malawian diet that's responsible or necessary for the severe weight loss phenotype? And yes, that is the case. So all other combinations produced essential weight stability over this period of time after transplantation. The sobering observation was as follows. When we next gave these animals RETF, so look at the experimental scheme again. First they receive a Malawian diet, then they receive RUTF formulated based on the formulation that Mark uses together with his colleagues in Malawi, give them RUTF for a period of time and then switch them back to a Malawian diet. So when they're on RUTF, there's a reconfiguration of the microbiota. And in the microbiota of recipients of kwashiorkor microbial community, there's a dramatic increase in the representation of bifidobacteria, lactobacilli, fecal bacteria, organisms that have been previously associated with benefit. But once the RUTF is withdrawn, this reconfiguration is not enduring, and the animal's microbiota, transplanted microbiota, revert to the initial state. And that's also true with metabolism. So there are metabolic reconfigurations affecting carbohydrate metabolism, the biosynthesis of essential amino acids, which are dramatically increased, but it's short-lived. Once the RUTF is withdrawn, the repair of metabolic function is not sustained. And there's some very interesting things that do change. Sulfur is a precious resource, essential for growth, The combination of a Malawi microbiota a Malawian diet and a kwashiorkor microbiota produces much reduced levels of cysteine and methionine. We know from experimental animals that deficiency in sulfur is associated with weight loss. That's also true in children with kwashiorkor who have deficiencies in cysteine and methionine. We can imagine that this combination of diet and microbiota produces metabolic insufficiency that is only transiently repaired by RUTF. The other observation metabolically in terms of the host side is that the combination of a kwashiorkor microbiota and a Malawian diet produces a set of chemicals or chemical that inhibits the host TCA cycle. So you can imagine the problem of being on an energy-limited diet and also having your TCA cycle inhibited. So now we have a series of taxonomic and metabolic biomarkers associated with disease, and we see that repair of the microbiota is only transient, and we ask ourselves whether additional effort has to be made to sustain repair so the healthy growth can continue. And that's been a major theme of the work, and I'm going to talk about that a little bit further. But first, you might wonder, how about mucosal barrier function? And you've heard Mark talk about environmental enteropathy. We thought it would be great if a technology could be construed whereby we could take a snapshot of barrier function without perturbing the human host. And an 8 meter long gut represents a formidable challenge to auditing mucosal barrier function. So Andy Cao, who's a really talented postdoc in the lab, and Joe Planer, who's an MSTP student in the lab, have been working together with colleagues to develop a new technology which we call BugFex. So the idea is that the principal adaptive immune response at mucosal surfaces is the production of IgA. IgA is very stable, it's a molecule, and the hypothesis was that the look of the microbiota that occurs at the level of the mucosa's immune system is influenced not only by who's in the microbiota, what the surface features of microbes are, which in turn could be influenced by diet, and also the physical proximity of elements of the microbiota to those cells that are critical for antigen recognition and processing. So was there a different look when the microbiota was kwashiorkor microbiota and a diet was a Malawian diet? And can we take a look at this from the perspective of these humanized animals, at least initially? So transplant a microbiota from a kwashiorkor or a healthy co-twin into a mouse and look at the microbes that had bound mouse IgA. And you look at these microbes using a fecal sample and FACS, fluorescent activated cell sorting, but adapted not to cells that have the dimensions of eukaryotic cells, but rather that have the dimensions of a microbe. And you adapt the system so that not only can you see IgA positive microbial cells in a fecal microbiota, but you can sort them, separate them from IgA negative taxa without killing the microbes. So that technology was developed, and this is the experiment initially that was done by Andy. A fecal sample from a mouse with a kwashiorkor co-twin microbiota, and that mouse was fed a Malawian diet. On the other end of the spectrum, a fecal sample from a mouse that received a healthy co-twin's microbiota and fed a healthy diet. Do the bug facts, separate out the fractions, IgA plus from the kwashiorkor mouse, from the healthy mouse. Transplant this fraction of purified taxa into another group of germ-free animals fed a Malawian diet. Do that for the consortium that has been purified from the mouse with the healthy co-twins microbiota fed a healthy diet. But also mix the two fractions before gavaging a third group of animals that are also fed a Malawian diet. And these are the questions that were asked. Does the IgA plus fraction from mouse with a Quercia corcotua microbiota contain microbes detrimental to the health? What would happen with the healthy? Would they rescue any pathology? So the first thing that this technology showed us is that there were differences in the populations of organisms targeted by IgA when the donor had Quercia core. And again, the donor's microbiota is transplanted into the mouse, and we're sampling the mouse fecal microbiota. And this just shows the IgA enrichment in fecal samples obtained from a mouse that had a Quercia core microbiota that was fed a Malawian diet. And there's a significant increase in the representation of Enterobacteriaceae in this mouse compared to all the other groups. Quash, healthy diet, healthy microbiota, Malawian diet, healthy microbiota, healthy diet. We also see an increased representation of Akkermansia mucinophilia, for instance, in animals that had a healthy microbiota. And this organism has been closely associated with the human intestinal mucosa and is thought in part to have a protective role in IBD. So what happens when you transplant these different fractions into the recipient mice, all the recipient mice receiving a Malawian diet? Well, there is an exaggerated phenotype, a very abrupt weight loss phenotype when mice receive the Quercia core IgA plus fraction, and lethality. If you don't see that with the healthy IgA plus consortia recipients, but if you mix the two fractions before you gavage the animal, you rescue the lethality. So this is what happens with the Quash Mal IgA plus fraction. Just in a 10-day period of time, these are several different experiments done independently. We don't see this lethality with the recipients of the healthy, and the mix rescues the lethality. Now, that's the starting point for identifying what are the active ingredients in the healthy that rescue. And we have it down to two organisms that are nominally part of a discovery pipeline for identifying new next-generation probiotics. Now, I just want to, as a group of individuals committed to better understanding and defining human development, say that we are able to apply a variety of computational approaches to identify taxa that are associated in healthy populations with particular age bins. So this is a Malawian population. These are the healthy twin pairs, concordant for healthy status. And these are taxa that are significantly associated with different ages. And we can assemble this signature of age in the form of microbial biomarkers and predict or define the age of a microbiota, and ask the question of whether the degree of maturation, now defined by this microbial signature, is associated with disease. Okay, so we're looking at it in a slightly different way than we did before. The first time I showed you based on the representation of genes encoding enzymes and how that changes as a function of age. Now we have a little bit easier method based on which microbial taxa are represented in a particular sample. And this is Satish Subramanian and Laura Van Arendonk, who are very talented students in the lab who've been working on this project, defining the maturation of a microbiota and its relationship to undernutrition. And this is a study that also was done in Malawi. It didn't involve children that exclusively had severe acute malnutrition. Its primary target was stunting. And this is a microbiota maturity index. And I'd like you to think about this going forward, because I think, at least from our work, we're going to try to see how generalizable this is. So imagine maturity based on the age of the human being harboring a microbiota and the defined age of their microbiota based on the representation of these age discriminatory taxa. And then associate that degree of maturity with certain host markers. In this case, anthropometric measurements, height versus age Z-score, weight versus age G-score, WHZ. And in this particular study, shown either this way as a microbiota immaturity. So in this case, a -4 would mean that the microbiota was 4 months more immature than the age of the host. And you can correlate the maturity index with anthropometric measurements. So we see at 18 months of age a significant relationship between microbiota maturity and anthropometry. Immature microbiota associated with Z-scores indicative of malnutrition. Immaturity associated with malnutrition. Bug facts. Now we can ask, are there differences in the look of the adaptive immune system in a microbiota of an individual at 6 months of age who is healthy versus someone who's stunted? So there are different configurations. And yes, we start seeing differences in the representation of different taxa in the IgA plus fraction of individuals who are healthy or who have indications of malnutrition at 6 months of age. So when I talk about the coevolution of the microbiota and the mucosal immune system, we feel that this is going to be another biomarker of health status, in this case, the adaptive immune system and its interaction with the microbiome, and perhaps a predictor of whether an individual is at increased risk of developing moderate or severe malnutrition. This is not unique to Malawi. So there has been another study that we've been collaborating in, and that's an acute phase of severe acute malnutrition case control study done in Dhaka, in Bangladesh, by our colleague Tamid Ahmed and Syed Hook. And in this particular case, children are enrolled where they have anthropometric measurements indicating that they have severe acute malnutrition. And they are assigned to two treatment arms, one with Plumpy Nut and the other with a local food source. Again, the hope here is that the food would be more affordable, particularly if it had to be given for longer periods of time. So for about 4 to 6 weeks, they're put on this treatment, one or the other, and then they're followed over time. And again, using the healthy controls, the twin pairs in Bangladesh now that we followed, in addition to the twin pairs we followed in Malawi, we can identify age discriminatory taxa, and we can look at the maturation of the microbiota as a function of time of presentation with disease, as a function of treatment, as a function of follow-up. And I just want to focus your eyes on this. This is the group of individuals who were assigned to the Plumpy Nut arm. This is at enrollment. This is during treatment with Plumpy Nut. This is the end of the nutritional rehabilitation. You see that the immaturity index improves by 2 to 3 months. It takes a while, but look at this period of, during this period of follow-up, you have a regression to a more immature state. And the degree of improvement was not significantly greater with Kachiri Hawa, the local cereal-based food, as it was with Plumpy Nut. And again, you see this regression. This is the anthropometric measurements, and you can see improvement in anthropometric measurements, but there is not a rescue fully of anthropometric parameters. So the question is there partial repair of a microbiota as a result of these interventions? But these children are walking around with a still malformed microbial metabolic organ, and that part of the long-term sequelae of malnutrition may reflect this inadequate function at the level of the microbiota. I'll tell you, by the way, that when we take the microbiota from Malawian children that are immature, associated with malnutrition, and transplant it into very young mice, the degree of gain of body mass is significantly less on a prototypic donor diet than if the microbiota was from an age-matched individual but judged to be more mature. So this immaturity appears to be critical to support growth. We have to look at the mechanism. So we're moving towards a clinical trial for more effective repair or restoration of microbiome functions. Ideally, if it's going to take a long period of time, we'd like to have, as Indy and Mark allude to, affordable RUTF. We're going to change the timing and duration of administration. We'll ask the question whether food alone can repair and whether there's going to be a need for cell-based therapy. In this case, cell-based therapy isn't human cells in this regenerative medicine metaphor, but rather microbial cells. And there are all sorts of ethical, social, and cultural considerations that have to be addressed, I believe, at the very start of these projects. I think informed consent, you heard a little bit about that. How do you clearly state what a microbiota and microbiome is? And is such understanding critical for valid consent? How about use of these samples? If bug facts can serve as a pipeline for identifying next generation probiotics, if we want to try to develop a better RUTF, how are we going to use these samples? How do we explain that to the donor? What are the issues about ownership of microbes? What are belief systems about self? And as microbes exit our gut, are they no longer considered part of self, or are they part of self? The issue of kinship, I talked about this family sharing of microbes. The governance, how about biopiracy? If we are to identify cell-based therapies with next-generation probiotics, are these efforts governed as human biological materials, or defined as human biological materials? Or are they non-human biological materials? And there's a lot to be considered, particularly with respect to the Convention on Biological Diversity, something that was signed by most countries in 1992, 1993, and pointed towards fair and equitable sharing of benefits resulting from genetic resources. We have assembled a group of cultural anthropologists and people who are interested in bioethics. One of these individuals gave a university-wide lecture a week ago at the Brown School. We think that this should be an issue that all of us need to consider jointly and to embrace the dimensionality of microbiome research, particularly in low-income countries, before things get out of hand. Alan, what is my time right now?
I'm 12.
I could give you a 10-minute a view of obesity, or I could stop now. It's up to the chairman of the Department of, okay.
Just before lunch.
Yeah, right, exactly. And I have David Rudnick here and Bob Hoikerow to help defend me against any vegetables that are thrown or tasers. So I was lucky enough to have them in the lab. I can define malnutrition both as undernutrition, the inadequate representation of energy or certain nutrients. I could also define malnutrition as obesity. We are as captivated by obesity as we are undernutrition, hoping that our studies of both and the technologies needed to develop insights about both will complement one another. So let's take the obsession we have about twins I show you the picture of another really outstanding graduate student lab, Vanessa Radar. We have a wonderful co-conspirator at Washington University, Andrew Heath, who's followed a group of Missouri-born twins. They now live all over the United States. They're female, same-gender twin pairs, who were enrolled at age 12 to 13 and have been followed for 20 years. So we asked Andrew if he could find stably discordant twin pairs, discordance for obesity. And Vanessa transplanted the microbiota of each co-twin in a discordant pair into a group of germ-free animals. Same genetic strain, monitored food consumption carefully. Each donor into a group of five mice, each experiment repeated at least three times across four twin pairs. When the donor was an obese co-twin, you transmitted an increased adiposity phenotype. You also transmitted obesity-associated metabolic abnormalities, including differences in levels of branched-chain amino acids and differences in the way carbohydrates are fermented. I could spend a long time about those metabolic phenotypes, but I want to try to show you a pipeline to try to understand how we might be able to not only understand mechanism, but also create next generation probiotics. Okay, so you can transplant these discordant body composition phenotypes, and by the way, they're not associated with any significant differences in food consumption. In this case, the diet is really a standard mouse chow, low in fat and rich in plant polysaccharides. Now, can we do the same thing? So this is an intact, uncultured microbiota. Inspired by the generous donation of Professor Saunders the concept of a personalized an in silico experiment we did, a Gedanken experiment, where we could think about creating personal culture collections from an individual. What Vanessa did next was to try to see whether you can transmit that body composition phenotype, that discordant body composition phenotype, and metabolic phenotypes with a culture collection from a obese co-twin or the lean co-twin in a discordant pair. And this is the experiment that she did. Culture collection was created, sequence the microbes in the culture collection, take the lean co-twins culture collection and transplant it into a group of mice. Those recipients I'll call LN animals. The obese co-twins culture collection, I'll call those recipients OB. Wait for about 5 days, which is necessary for the transplanted community to achieve a quasi-equilibrium. And then co-housed LN with LN as one control. And in this case, you have multiple cages with the LN-LN, and the experiment as a whole is replicated a number of times. The OB-OB are co-housed. And then, the interesting experiment, the battle of the microbiota. You co-house the LN and OB recipients 5 days after they received their transplant together. And in a fourth arm of the experiment, surround the battle with a Greek chorus. That is to say, you put in germ-free animals just at the time of co-housing. So the preview is that, lo and behold, with the culture collection, the recipients of the obese co-twins culture collection gains more adiposity than the recipients of the LN, just like the intact uncultured microbiota. The battle of the microbiota. You prevent in the obese co-housed animal the increase in adiposity if there is a lean LN cage mate. And the LN cage mate, by the way, is impervious to the presence of the OB. It doesn't manifest a change in its adiposity compared to LN-LN controls. And by the way, the germ-free, the Greek chorus, looks just like the LN co-housed or the LN-LN controls. And that's true not only with body composition, that's true with the metabolic phenotypes. So you can rescue the metabolic phenotypes. Why should that be? This is an invasion analysis. The pointer is absolutely critical. Otherwise, you'll be not able to follow this. And this is not a political statement. They're not red states or blue states here. We are all filled with microbes. What you're able to do is to follow, what Vanessa is able to do is to follow which microbes are in which animal as a function of transplantation before co-housing and then as a function of co-housing. So these are the dominant organisms that are present in the guts of recipients of the LN donors culture collection. And then with co-housing, there's not much of a change. These are the more dominant organisms in the recipients of the obese co-twins culture collection. But once co-housing occurs, you see that they're displaced by the LN. So the LN invades the OB. The OB doesn't invade the LN. And the Greek chorus looks like the LN. So this invasion is associated with these changes in body composition and metabolic phenotypes. And actually, we can look at the principal invaders. The principal invaders are the Bacteroidetes. This one is particularly interesting to us, Bacteroides celluloliticus. It's one of the more dominant organisms. I'll talk about that in a second. But we're able to do a series of correlation analysis and look at invasion as a function of change in metabolic phenotype, as a function of change in adiposity, and try to nominate organisms that we think are the principal mediators of these changes. We take those organisms from our culture collection, put them into a group of animals, so they have a subset of the culture collection, and then co-house them with the recipients of the obese twins culture collection, and follow the battle of the microbiota with what we call a series of skirmishes. That's how we are identifying next generation probiotics. Those of you who aren't too hungry will say, hey, Jeff, why isn't there an epidemic of leanness in the United States? What's happened? Well, lunch has happened, my friends. Let me just describe how lunch and dinner have affected us. So even if you're a graduate student in our state of chronic nutrient deprivation, you would prefer ramen noodles to Mao Zedong. And therefore, what we did is do a follow-up experiment in which we used the NHANES database of food consumption by Americans and chose a diet based on those food consumption patterns that was representative of the lower tertile of consumption of saturated fats and the upper tertile of fruits and vegetables. We also constructed a diet that was representative of the upper tertile of saturated fats and the lower tertile of fruits and vegetables consumption. So we feed those diets to the mice and do the battle of the microbiota. So when you take the low saturated fat, high fruits and vegetables diets, we see that there is a discordance in body mass and adiposity develops, where the OB culture collection recipients have an increased body mass and increased adiposity, and co-housing rescues. That the same invasion occurs, the principal actors are the same, principal invaders are the Bacteroides. Not only that, but when we do metabolic profiling, we see signatures of insulin resistance. So you know that acyl-carnitine profiling can give us an idea about insulin resistance, that obesity-related insulin resistance is associated with broad-scale accumulation of acyl-carnitines in skeletal muscle. You have changes in mitochondrial beta oxidation, and there are a variety of ways in which you can manipulate that genetically. But we think this is an interesting signature of insulin resistance. Through targeted MSMS to measure amino acids as well as 60 acyl-carnitine species in skeletal muscle, liver, and serum from these experimental animals. And the interesting thing is that OB-OB controls have significant accumulation of even long-chain acyl-carnitines in their skeletal muscle, plus a matching pattern in their liver. This is a proxy or a phenotype associated with insulin resistance, and that co-housing rescues this. And it suggests that the microbiome has the capacity to directly regulate beta oxidation in muscle. I think that's pretty striking, and we're very interested in how those principal invaders might affect this change, and to do euglycemic hyperinsulinemic clamps, but we have to develop new technology to do that because these are notobiotic animals. You have to do it in, not easy. Now remember I said, here's the hazards of lunch. Now the high saturated fat, low fruits and vegetable diet is applied in the same experimental paradigm. Except for now, and in the previous slide, we're using an intact uncultured microbiota. So we're making the circumstances much more real. We're not just using a culture collection. If you get this diet, you see this discordance in body mass phenotype between OB and lean. The thing that's interesting is you don't rescue with co-housing. You don't rescue with co-housing, you don't get invasion with co-housing. So the ability to invade is very diet dependent. So that takes us to a sweet spot what can we add to a bad American diet that we're giving to these animals that would promote not only invasion but rescue of metabolic phenotypes? And we know the principal invaders, we know their genome sequences, and I mentioned B. celluloliticus. This is an organism that's actually quite remarkable in terms of how little has been published. There's one paper published to date. It was isolated from human feces in 2007. I only have 2 minutes more to go, so your peristalsis won't be impaired. This organism has the largest glycobiome that's been reported to date. When we sequence this genome, it has an unbelievable repository of carbohydrate-active enzymes breaking down plant polysaccharides, more so than any other organism. The human genome, by the way, encodes 99 of these enzymes. This organism has 503. It's a dominant invader, and we can crack the code of which carbohydrates it covets most. And the way we can do that is first in silico, looking at its genome and figuring out which enzymes are particularly enriched. These enzymes are parked in clusters called polysaccharide utilization loci that consist of a transcriptional regulator, a series of enzymes that breaks down particular types of carbohydrates. Each locus has a different repertoire of these enzymes. It also has two proteins that are critical for binding and importing polysaccharides. So the idea is that each pole has specificity for different types of polysaccharides. And this organism has 113 of these polysaccharide utilization loci. So we can figure out in a principal invader which carbohydrates it covets because we want to add those carbohydrates to this bad American diet. And this is the way we do it very quickly. You grow this organism in culture in the presence of a bunch of different carbohydrates, figure out which one it grows on, do in vitro RNA-seq to see which poles are induced. We compare the in vitro data to what we see in vivo. The in vitro data is like a Rosetta Stone. It breaks the code between which polysaccharides are presented and which polysaccharide utilization loci are induced at the level of gene transcription, and we can look at not only the invaders, but we can look in this invasion experiment which genes are expressed during the course of invasion. So these are the types of Rosetta Stones that we create, which is all the poles. This is RNA-seq in vitro with different polysaccharides, and we figure out which polysaccharides this organism covets. It's xylans that are principal ingredients of cereals. So we put cereals into this American diet, and that's what we're doing as we speak now. So here's the summary. You've been very patient. Translational research pipeline. Start with humans having physiological phenotypes of interest. Discordant twin pairs, if you're obsessed like we are with twins. Test transmissibility of their phenotypes via microbiota transplants. First, the complete community, then the culture collection. These mice with replicated microbiota in controlled environments allow us to do many layers of analysis of information flow, DNA level, mRNA level, protein level, metabolite level, immune profiling, bug facts. Co-housing experiments, battle of the microbiota, follow-up skirmishes, different diet contexts, nominate next generation probiotic leads, and then put those organisms into mice and repeat the battle. These leads then have to go forward into humans. And of course, our belief is that these organisms represent family assets. In the case of discordant twins, one of the beauties of these preclinical models is you incorporate, or have to incorporate in your thinking, the very human population you wish to treat in the mouse model, because it's their microbiota that are incorporated. So, last comment. This is a wonderful field to educate ourselves, particularly about the human condition and the very ways that we live. And I think it's a field that allows us, as citizens of the planet, to address some of the most vexing health problems that we face this century. It's interdisciplinary. It's wonderful for creating innovative partnerships, whether it be with engineers, with systems biologists, with endangered scientific species like glycobiologists. a different view of human nutrition that I think is going to profoundly affect the food industry, the gut-brain axis, malnutrition, and how does that affect neural development, cultural anthropologists. And I think the public is captivated. New perceptions about self, new expectations about how we might have a different form of a 21st century medicine cabinet. But we need sobriety. We need to translate from bench to bedside very carefully. It's going to be a challenge for regulatory agencies to define next generation probiotics as probably drugs. How do we define food if we look at it in terms of health? And I think for all those involved, it's very critical that we participate actively, much like those who are involved in recombinant DNA research, in a public discourse about societal benefit and peril, and use the precautionary principle. Thank you for your attention. Bon appetit, and may the force be with you.